You ready?
I think so.
All right, I'll meet you up there.
Jet. There may not be any viewers tonight. Not even you. Let's log in. Two viewers. Three viewers. Where's hello, everyone. Welcome to our Tuesday Sew Along. So, happy spring. It's a little gray and cold today, but at least we see glimmers that spring's coming. And so we're happy about that. So, welcome. Today, we're going to be working on block number 25. It's called a winged four-patch, and we'll be talking about that in just a little bit. So, Just a little reminder, today was the beginning of our Spring Fling Shop Hop, and this is year 20, so if you get a chance to get out and visit us, we started today, but you still have 9 more days, not counting Sunday and Monday, because everybody's closed on those days, but there's all of the participating shops are open 9 to 5 during the next 9 days for our Spring Fling Shop Hop. And come and see us. We have little goodies for you. Plus, we have some great prizes that we'll be drawing for at the end of the shop pop. So tonight's block looks like, wrong camera, that. So it is a flying goose around some four patches. We'll talk about that in a minute. And the flying geese are actually two colored side pieces with a matching center, or I call that the goose part, and the sky part is two colors. And we're going to talk about how to do that. So you have options for how you do the four patches. So let's talk about that first. You can do oversized four patches, trim them down. You could use the four patch square up tool. You would actually also use the tucker trimmer tool. But let's look at that for just a minute. So I have my plate with my four patches over here. Let me get rid of those. Or the components for my four patches, I guess I should say. So I've got my pieces here, and I've actually started with strips. And I need a strip that is red, because I have some red four patches and some white four patches. So I have a strip that is red, a strip that is white, and a strip that is blue that is twice as long. So we're going to talk about how I did that. So I'm just going to take this over to the sewing area, and I need two of this arrangement and two of this arrangement. So that's what I'm going to be working on first. And then I'll just put the ring around it so you can see what that's going to look like if I just had those outer pieces. That could actually be an interesting block. Just insert anything in the center that will be the right size. But I want to show you how I did this. So I have one long piece of my navy, and I've got my red piece, and I just cut it in half. So I'm going to sew on my red, just using my quarter inch seam allowance. And I'm just going to sew. And I had three pieces that were all the same length. I cut the red and the white in half, and I just left my blue intact. I want to show you what I did. I do this often. If I have four patches that I've got assorted colors, I just stop sewing on the red and add my white on the same blue strip. Now, I could cut the blue in half. I just find this just as quick to do this, and I have all the pieces I need. Now, I like to sew on half strips if I can, strips across half of the width of the fabric. They're just a little easier to control. So do try that. It makes it a little easier to press and get it to lay down the way I want it to. So we're going to go back to the overhead camera. I see a lot of people from all over. I know Betty's from Florida, and I see one from southern Georgia. And I know Phyllis is from the Chicago area. So we've got people from all over. So let's go back to, let me get to the right camera. And I'm going to show you what I would do with this. And while my iron is heating up, I want to talk a little bit about the best way to press this. Because you can actually distort your strips when you've done a strip set that you're going to cut segments to make your four patches. Now on this, I have decided to press everything toward the common color. So my common color is this navy. And I'm just going to give it a quick little finger press. I like to finger press everything. And that's kind of why I don't have great fingernails, because I'm just always scraping them along a seam to get the seam laying the way I want it to before I ever start with my iron. So I've got all of my pieces, and I'm just going to set my iron down on it and give it time to let the iron heat into the fabric. And then we're going to just move this over. And that was just a little piece of metal beside my iron. It made a lot of loud noise, but for no really good reason. Let me turn this iron around. There we go. So now I'm ready to cut these segments apart. Let me get rid of these four patches. And when you're making four patches, especially in this particular case where all of the squares are the same size, whatever size this strip is, that's how big you want to cut your segment. So I'm just going to grab a regular ruler, if I can find what I did with it. I've lost this two or three times today. And so my strips that I cut and started with are 2.5 inches. So that means I'm going to need to cut 2.5 inch segments. And I like to put one of the horizontal lines on my ruler parallel to the seam. And that way I know that I'm straight here and I can cut and be assured that I'm going to have a straight square when I cut. Now, one thing you might have noticed, I went past the 2.5 inch mark, and now I can just twist this around and line up the 2.5 inch line on the cut edge. Again, I'm going to line up a horizontal line across that seam, and there's one segment, and I can go all the way across. And I have been known to stack these. Since I'm just making one set, I'm not going to worry about doing that. But I actually only need four segments of each color to make the four patches that I need. So there's that one. And again, I'm going to go past my 2.5 inch mark, line that up, and I'm lining up a horizontal mark on the seam so I know that I'm still straight with my seam, and line this up right across the seam and along the 2.5 inch line on my cut edge. And I need four segments of this color arrangement to make the four patches that I need in this color. So of course, when you're making these Blockbuster patterns, you can choose whatever color you like. You don't have to stick with my color choices. I'm lining up right there and right there. And so now I have all the segments I need for my four patch units. And all I'm going to do is twist that around so that I have a way to nest those seams. I'm just going to stitch the blue and white ones real quick, even though I've already got what I need for the block actually stitched. And there they are. So these have to be 2-inch finished units. I chose on this particular block not to make those four patches oversized, but you certainly could. So I've got my opposites, and I'm just going to nest those two seams right there. So I can lock those in. I can feel those with my fingertips. I guess if I move my camera where you could actually see what I'm doing, that would be better. But I have my seams nested, so they lock in, and I'm going to start stitching. And I'm just using my quarter-inch patchwork foot. I'm sewing right along the edge to get my quarter-inch measurement. And after I get to the middle, then I adjust here at the back, the ending corner that I'm going to stitch. So I didn't have to pin anything. If you like to pin, that's perfectly fine. But I find sometimes if I'm pinning, I can actually distort more than if I don't pin. So again, I'm nested right there, and I'm going to hold on to that right there. Let me adjust that again because I shifted it when I laid it down. And I've nested there. I'm going to start stitching. When I get to the center here, then I can let go of it. But until I get it under the needle, I just kind of hold on to it. And then I adjust here at this end where it's going to finish sewing that seam. And once I get that stitched, I'm just going to grab a fabric tag, stitch it on, and I'm ready to press. And so I would do a little twizzle on this. That means I'm going to just split that. And usually I can twist it just a little bit, and it'll look like a tiny four patch, so that when I press this, all the seams are going to lay down nice and flat. And I just give it a quick little finger press, both directions, and I'm ready to take this to the iron. So let's just go finish this up real quickly so you can see how I would do that. Now, some of you who have been using the Acorn pressing pin might have noticed I did not use the Acorn pressing pin on my strip set. I certainly could have. I'm just going to give this just a quick press just to get it heated up. And then I'm just going to give it a quick little swipe both directions, set the iron on it, and let the iron do the work. So I'm finished with that unit. And because I didn't use big, long strips, the longer your strip, the more chance you have of distorting. It's ready to go into my block. It's already the sizes I need. You can, of course, make that a little bigger than the 2.5-inch strips. You would cut whatever size strips you started with. That's how big your segments would be. And then you can trim that down using the four-patch square up. So that is an option for your centers. So I wanted to kind of rush through that because I wanted to talk to you about how I got two-toned flying geese. Notice that they're an opposite color arrangement, and I'm going to show you how I did that. So I actually had two of my large squares, and I had four red small squares and four blue, my navy, small squares. So I want to go back to the chart and talk a little bit about how I know exactly what I need to stitch. I'm not sure whether I've got wing clipper up. Yep, there it is. So the wing clipper process, this is the basic process for doing wing clipper. And notice you start with five squares, one large square and four small squares. Now my squares were a large square that was a background color and four small squares that were either blue or red. And I can figure out what size squares to start with by the height and width of my goose. The catch is how I'm going to use my colored squares to be able to end up with flying geese that have two different colors of sky area. So I'm going to position and stitch and trim, and then I'm going to press. And the second position and sewing is where I'm going to do the tweaking to make that come out the way I want it to. So I actually have already stitched on. I drew my two lines. I've stitched on two red squares on one of my squares and two blue squares on my other background square. So one thing I wanted to point out, for those of you that are new to the Wing Clipper tool, and I know we have some new people because there were some ladies in the shop today at the Shop Hop that were not familiar with Wing Clipper. So I showed them how it worked, told them to be sure and tune in tonight because I was going to demonstrate it again. And this is the basic process that you would use. So this is not a new process for making flying geese, but generally, if you're finding this technique in a magazine or a book, they would have you line up these small squares right on the corner. Where we differ, I have scooted my small squares toward the center on both ends. So I have just a little bit of that back square, the background square in this case, showing on the outer corner here and here. So that gives me a little more wiggle room when it's time to trim later. I have used my magic wand just kind of to give you the rundown and a review. I've used my magic wand and I've drawn on stitching lines. I've stitched on both lines and now I'm ready to cut that apart. You want to grab something that's big enough to protect your fingers and just cut across between the lines of stitching, and I'm going to do it again. So if I was making flying geese, for instance, that had two red wings, I'll show you what I would do. Let me move this out of my way so I have room to get my iron over here. And I want to press toward the smaller triangle. And I also finger press this. That way the seams go the way I want them to go from the very beginning. And I'm just going to set the iron on them and let the iron heat them up. I'm getting another one ready. Set the iron on that. Then I'm going to grab my acorn pressing pin. My iron is running away. And I actually, in case you didn't know it, I have a piece of press board under here, and I've kind of warped it ironing, so it kind of wants to run away from me sometimes, so I have to be careful with it. So I'm just going to give it a finger press, set the iron on it, and notice I overlap my units as I'm pressing. That gives them just a little bit of extra time under the heat, and I like to use the acorn pressing pin just to flatten out that seam. And you don't have to put a lot on. You don't even have to be able to see the liquid on there when you swipe the pin down that seam. It gets enough on there to do the job, and I just let the heat do it. If you feel the need to press down, that won't hurt it, but I haven't really found that to be necessary to get what I want. Now let's go back to the sewing area and talk about what I would do next, depending on the color combination that I would want. So if I wanted to make flying geese that had red on all of the wing parts, all of the sky parts, I would put red matching the color that I had started with. And I would do that on all of them. If I had red here, I'd put red on the next square. If I had blue here, I would put blue there, and that would give me, after I stitch and cut, that would give me my geese that have the two matching colors. I want them to be opposite, so instead of putting red on red, I'm going to put blue on my red. And again, I'm going to scoot away from the corner here so that I can see this little bit of the back part of my goose. And I like to sew from the point part, but you could certainly start sewing this direction. It would still work. The reason I like to sew from the point part is because I can get that overlapped the way I want it to. Have just two or three threads of that back background square, what started out as a square, now it's a triangle, and stitch on the line. And I'm going to grab another one. Again, if I started with red, this time I'm going to put blue, and I'm going to flip it around, and I'm going to start with the corner, and I want to leave two or three threads on the corner. That gives me the wiggle room I need to have enough to trim away. And I'm just going to stitch across my line. And I had already drawn my lines on there. I'm sure you noticed that. So now I have a blue one. If I started with blue, now I'm going to put red. So whatever color you're alternating with, you just want them to be opposite. It doesn't matter. I could have started with my red and put red on all of the ones that I sewed first, and then put blue on all of my second steps. I didn't do it that way, but the instructions on the pattern instruct you to be consistent, and I am, because I started with blue and now I'm adding red, or I started with red and then I'm adding blue. So it will come out the way I want it to. And I'm just going to stitch right down that line. When you get to the end, I can either take my fabric tag and sew off of that and cut, or typically what I do is just turn and sew across and then start back the other direction. And sew on the line and then just go from one segment to the next. And once you get your colors placed on there, it's the same process you would have done if you all of your geese colors were the same. So I have to tell you something interesting today. Most of you know that my name is Pam Goggins. Today I got a call from Pam Goggins, who happens to be a quilter from California, and she writes patterns. So I thought that was really interesting. And in talking to her, our husbands have to be some cousins along the line somewhere, because their families all came from the same little county in Ireland. So I just thought that was very interesting. Somebody had seen, one of her friends had seen one of my patterns and showed it to her. And she said, I just have to call. And so there's another Pam Goggins out there that's also a quilter, just in case you didn't know. All right, so now I'm ready to go and cut these apart. I've stitched on both lines, and I'm going to grab just the edge of my wing clipper and cut between my lines. And it's going to give me the colors I need just automatically. Now, you may have noticed that I have an opposite coloring combination, and I'll show you with this one. When I get my two pieces stitched, this is from one of my segments, they're on my red triangles are on opposite sides of my flying geese, which works great for this block. And if you wanted, if you wanted to do one where all of the reds were on the right side and all the blues were on the left side, that's also possible, but that's a different technique. And there is a technique sheet that explains that. It's called Geese of a Feather. And we will be doing that later in the series. But for this one, you don't need matching flying geese. You need those opposite units. So I'm just going to trim these four. We'll put those aside. And I'll trim those later. And so for those of you who are new to the wing clipper tool, often, especially on the first time you're using the wing clipper, you would have matching triangles on the two, I call those the sky part and this the goose part. But in this case, I've got two different colors. So on my wing clipper tool, I have some lines that I'm going to line up with these seams. Let me scoot up a little bit so you can see everything I'm doing. So this line is always going to go on this right seam, no matter what size I'm making. And I'm pointing that valley toward me. So I'm right-handed. This is how I would orient my tool and my unit to trim. If you're left-handed, simply turn it so that your goose points to the right and your tool lines up vertically. So I'm not left-handed. I'm not going to try that. But this line will line up on the seam of this right side. And then there's going to be a line on this side according to the size I'm making. that will line up. Now, if I get my tool down here and I can see there's quite a bit to trim away here, you need to check and see if you're on the right line. And I am not. This needs to be a 2x4 goose. If I happen to get my lines here, they match up on the seams, but I don't have anything to trim away. So I know I'm not on the right line there. This is not the right line either. So when I get to the right place, first of all, I notice it fits with just a tiny sliver all the way around that rectangle to trim away. Plus, I know I need a 2x4 goose, and this is going to be trimmed to 2.5 by 4.5. Those are the numbers right there. And I line up here and here. And excuse me, I knew it was coming, but you know. All right, so I'm ready to trim up and over. And it's just that tiny little sliver that I'm trimming off. And sometimes about all I trim away is the ears that I would have cut off with my scissors anyway. Turn your unit 180 degrees. Now the 4.5 by 2.5 inch lines are going on my cut edges. And once I get those in place, you'll notice a bold X right at the tip. So you're not gonna chop off your goose's beak. And I can trim up and over. And again, a lot of times what I'm cutting is that ear that I don't want anyway. So there's my perfectly trimmed goose. Now here's another one. This one's going to be the opposite color arrangement. Again, I'm going to line up this long common diagonal on the right seam, find the appropriate line on the left seam, and this is my 2.5 by 4.5 inch goose. Now, if you tend to have your tool kind of slip on you, you can actually add InvisiGrip, which is a vinyl cling that you can put on the back side of your ruler. It makes it not quite as slippery. For the most part, I prefer not to have the InvisiGrip on my tool because I like to be able to slide my ruler into place and then muscle it down and hold it in place. I think I need a new blade. What do you think? And there's my second goose that is the right color combination for what I want to do. So I want to show you how this is put together. Let me make sure you can see what I'm doing. So I've got all these geese that are opposites, which is what I want. And I'm going to put my 4 patches that I've made. I had some already done, so I'm going to put those in here. And I like to have, on this particular version, I want to have it goes this way. So you can play with this until you get the arrangements you want. I put the 4 patches on here first, just so I can see a chain of white and a chain of blue. And then I match up my flying geese with the colors that I want. So blue touches blue, this red touches white. And there's that one. And notice the reds are opposite each other on the corner. Blues are opposite each other on the corner. Blues are opposite each other. This one would go here. So there's my arrangement. And then I just have 4 plain squares for the corners. Now, of course, you don't have to arrange yours that way. You could actually flip them around and create a completely different look. You can arrange them so that the colors are completely different. But just think about this. This is a 12-inch finished block. That means that my 4 patches are 8 inches finished. I could put any 8-inch block in the center, and I could put these flying geese around it in any color combination I wanted and have a neat kind of frame around my block. So that is an option for you. Remember, you don't have to arrange your blocks in the same order that mine are arranged. You can put yours however you want. When you download the pattern, and if you don't get emails from me with the patterns, let me know and we can add you to our list. When you download the pattern, you're going to get 2 links. One of them is a link to my cutting directions for a 12.5 inch block. And of course, you don't have to stick with a 12.5 inch block. You could make it in several combinations of sizes. And in the patterns that you will download from the second link, it will tell you information about how to make those two colored geese that I showed you. It'll tell you sizing information if you want to make a different size. So there's good information. Plus, there's colored pictures that are different than the colors I chose. So that is an option for you as well. So any questions I need to answer? All right. So if you have friends that haven't joined us for our sew-alongs, invite them to join us. And they can go to the Sager Creek Quilts YouTube channel and watch the videos later. Or they can watch on Facebook later as well. So you can watch live or you can watch later. And if you are local, be sure and come and visit us for the Shop Hop before it's over. You've got 9 more days. So we'll see you next week. Until then,